students, welcome in today's lecture of the surgery. In today's lecture of the surgery, we'll be seeing one of the important hernia. Important hernia. What is important? Hiatus hernia. It is the one of the commonest type of the hernia among the all hernias are there. So what do you mean the hiatus hernia? That's mean it is a protrusion of viscous or part of viscous through hiatal opening. Hiatal opening, it's called esophageal opening. Esophageal opening. So the hiatus hernia is what? The hiatus hernia, it is a hernia or it is a protrusion of the viscous or the part of viscous through hiatal opening or esophageal opening. The esophageal opening into the diaphragm, it's called as a hiatal opening, and the protrusion occurs through that opening. Which opening? The esophageal opening into the diaphragm. They understood? And this hernia is called as a hiatus hernia. So that's why it is a type of diaphragmatic hernia. Diaphragmatic hernia. So diaphragmatic hernia means what? The herniation through the openings into the diaphragm. Herniation through the openings into the diaphragm. So abdominal content will be protruded through the different openings in diaphragm into the thorax. Then we call diaphragmatic hernia. But among these diaphragmatic hernia, the hiatal hernia is most common. And this is the which hernia? The protrusion of the viscous or the part of viscous through hiatal opening or the esophageal opening. Now the classification or types of the types of hiatus hernia. The hiatus hernia is mainly divided into two groups. One is on the basis of onset or occurrence, and second on the basis of pathology, or you can say anatomy, abnormal anatomy of the hernia. So on the basis of occurrence, the hernia is classed into groups: congenital and the acquired. And on the basis of this, the hernia is of the three types. One is sliding hiatus hernia. Second, rolling hiatus hernia. And third one is mixed or transitional hiatus hernia. So this is a classification. So on the basis of occurrence, I say on the basis of the pathology, or you can say the anatomy of the hernia. Means how does this protrusion occurs from the abdomen into the thorax. These are three types: sliding, rolling, and the mixed. Among these, the rolling is mostly congenital and the sliding is the acquired. Sliding may be slightly, or in some cases it may be also the congenital, but mostly it is the acquired hernia is there. And the rolling is usually the congenital hernia. So we'll see one by one these hernias, these types of the hernia. So the diagnostic classification, there are several different hernias are there, but we are only discussing about the hiatus hernia, because among the all diaphragmatic hernia, the hiatus hernia is the commonest one. Isn't it? And fourth type, the all type of the Had a surname, as you have seen, it is a mostly acquired. It is two types, the sliding hernia and second is the rolling hernia. In sliding hernia, the anatomical sliding hernia, where the esophagus slides upward and content of abdomen, it slides upward through the esophageal opening, and esophagus goes upward, slides upward, and the peritoneal sac it passes left from left side of the stomach into the thorax, isn't it? So that's a sliding. Sliding will just like this one. In sliding, the esophagus just slides upward, and peritoneal sac it protruded from this side into the thorax. It slides upward, goes upward. That's why it's called a sliding hernia, where it peritoneal sac slides from the left side of the stomach. Then rolling hernia, it means what? Where the peritoneal sac rolls over the esophagus, rolls around the esophagus. That is called a rolling type of the hernia. It will like this. This is the diaphragm. The esophagus is there, and this peritoneal sac will roll over here. So this type of the kind of rolling, and this is called a sliding, where only esophagus slides upward and your peritoneal sac rolls over or around the esophagus. It is called as a rolling hernia. Now you see etiology. The etiology of the sliding hernia. A. In some of the cases it may be congenital. In some cases it may be congenital due to short esophagus. It's a congenital, but only in the 5% of the cases. Because many of the arthritis says that by their study, that all the sliding hernia, almost all the sliding hernia are acquired. But on study, it's also found a few of the cases, about 5% or even less than the 5% cases, they are congenital, or congenitally they have the short esophagus, because it is seen in the children soon after the birth, producing effortless vomiting, that is the congenital shortening of the esophagus, isn't it? Second, here the mostly acquired the shortening of esophagus due to short esophagus is due to spasms of esophagus. You understood? Second, B, other factors are, number one, the enlargement of hiatal opening. Enlargement of the hiatal opening. So when the hiatal opening becomes enlarged, that becomes abnormal. The protrusion occurs through this opening, and this heterotopic limit is enlarged due to three reasons are there. One is muscular degeneration. Muscular degeneration. So muscle, diaphragm muscles and the other surrounding muscles, they undergo the degeneration. And due to degeneration of the muscle, this heterotopy becomes the enlarged and easily protrusion occurs through the this hiatal opening. Second, adipose or adiposity. Adiposity means in obese person. This also makes the enlargement of the hiatal opening. See, aplasia of right crest of the diaphragm. Right crest of diaphragm. Right crest of the diaphragm. Because if you see in normal anatomy, the right crest of the diaphragm is developed normally. If it develops normally, it will be produce pinching cock movements on the or pinching cock action on the hiatal opening and which causes the narrowing of the hiatal opening. But if this upplasia of this right crest, it will lead into enlargement of the hiatal opening and it becomes abnormal and easily there is a protrusion of the viscus or the part of viscus through the hiatal opening from abdomen into thorax with occurs. So do you understood? The second is what? The other factors, enlargement of the hiatal opening. Then second, here the laxity of tissue which binds the esophagus and which narrows the hiatal opening. These are number one, perivascular tissue that around the left gastric artery. This tissue, it produces the compression over this esophagus as well as on the hiatal opening, causing the narrowing of the opening there. But if laxity is in there, that will result into the widening of the or loosening of this cell, causes the protrusion of the viscus or the part of viscus through this hiatal opening. Do you understood? So first is what? Perivascular tissue. Second, diaphragmatic ligament. Third, phrenoesophageal ligament. If laxity in this diaphragmatic ligament and this phrenoesophageal ligament and the perivascular tissue, if occurs, that will lead into the hiatus hernia. Other factors, once hiatus hernia occurs, other factors may be cause the exaggeration of the hernia. That may be due to what? The negative pressure in the thorax or increased intra-abdominal pressure due to ovarian cyst or the flatulence or any other factors that causing increased intra-abdominal pressure that also facilitate the production of or the occurrence of the hiatus hernia. But it will be effect when already hernia gets developed. Do you understand? So these are the causes of the sliding hernia. Clinical features. Number one, the most of the patients are asymptomatic. Patients are asymptomatic. And they diagnose accidentally on the radiological examination. Most of people are asymptomatic. They don't have symptom. They are developing the hernia. Second, some of the patients are below the 10 years. Or children's develops soon after. Develops soon after birth will have suffer from the effortless vomiting. Effortless, soon after the birth, will have effortless vomiting. Effortless vomiting. Isn't it? Sometimes maybe it is with the blood. Some blood may be coming the vomiting. Then third group of the patients, there are some adult patients with acquired hernia will have regurgitation, a complaint of the regurgitation, complaints of regurgitation. Then third, fourth one, a general group of the patient, general group of patient means what? The typical patients that we developed a full hiatus hernia, or fully developed a hiatus hernia, and that patients have the maximum symptoms there. Which are that? The first one is pain. This pain is retrosternal and pain extending to the back between the two scapula, right? Intrascapular region, and may extend to the neck. So that is a pain. Second, regurgitation. Third, dysphagia. Difficulty in the swallowing there, isn't it? So these symptoms are there. Usually pain is present or retrosternally, and regurgitation space where lying down, and it's preventing the patient from the lying down. Sometimes there may be the pain into the left side of the chest. It mostly seen into the rolling type of hernia, which may seem like to the cardiac pain or heart affections are there. So these are the clinical features of the hiatus hernia. You understood that most of the patients are asymptomatic. The some of the patients are the children are there below 10 years, or some of the children or some of the patients are the children who develop the hernia soon after the birth. In these cases, there is effortless vomiting. In children, there is effortless vomiting is there. So simply is that in children there is effortless vomiting. That is a indication of the hiatus hernia. Remember. While some of the adult patients have only developed the regurgitation. Because it will not be the sure sign of the or symptom of the hiatus hernia, because regurgitation or reflux it occurs in the other cases also. In case of gastritis, esophagitis, in that also there will be the regurgitation of the reflux there. But the typical patient or the general group of the patient means what? The typical patient of the hiatus hernia who develop the symptoms of the hiatus hernia, and these symptoms are what? The pain, second is regurgitation, and the dysphagia. Pain, this is a retrosternal pain, extend to the back, intrascapular region, or in the neck, especially of the left side. And this pain usually occurs after lying down or after eating one there. Then regurgitation is there and the dysphagia. So these are the symptoms of the hiatus hernia. Investigations. The investigations that are carried out in case of the hiatus hernia are, number one, is the blood examination. Blood examination for the secondary anemia. Second, stool examination. examination for occlude blood. For occlude blood. So this you can take in the clinical features also. Secondary anime is a clinical features of the hiatus hernia. Occlude blood is also, occlude blood in stool is also one of the clinical features of the hiatus hernia. But not sure, in other cases also occur this one there. But usually the symptoms which you have seen already, pain, regurgitation and the dysphagia, then along with these symptoms are there, or these features are there, this will be a diagnostic of the hiatus hernia. So for diagnosis you have to blood examination, stool examination. Third, esophagoscopy. The examination of the esophagus. On examination you see this inflammation of the esophagus, constriction of the esophagus, that produces the dysphagia. So that is diagnosis of the hernia. And then barium mill examination. So you are allowed to drink the barium, or to allow to take the barium, and after that you have to take the x-ray. And if you ask the patient to lie down and take the x-ray lying down, what will happen in barium examination? The barium will be come back into the esophagus after the swallowing, after the drinking. So that will be diagnostic of the hiatus hernia. Do you understood? The first blood examination for the secondary anemia, stool examination for the occlude blood, and esophagoscopy for examination of esophagus with inflammation due to the reflux, or like reflux, esophagitis, and the barium mill examination. So that's all the investigation there. Then we'll go for the treatment. The treatment of the hiatus hernia. We'll see now treatment of the hiatus hernia. The treatment of hiatus hernia, A, for the asymptomatic patient or the simple hiatus hernia. Means what? The hiatus hernia, in which the patient don't have any symptoms are there, and this hernia is diagnosed only radiologically, on radiological examination, accidentally. In such cases, it doesn't require any treatment. Even we should not tell the patient that you have the hiatus hernia. Because if you tell the patient will develop the anxiety. And from that we will develop the acidity, all these things, regurgitations, and we will develop the symptoms are there. So that's why the patient with the asymptomatic hiatus hernia doesn't require any treatment, and don't tell him that you have the hernia. They understood? Then conservative treatment for the patients with the symptoms. The patients with the developed symptoms of the hiatus hernia have the two types of treatment. One is the conservative treatment, is also called as the medical treatment. And second one is the surgical treatment. The first one is the conservative treatment in the patients with the symptoms of the hernia without any complications. You have to do the conservative treatment. And what it includes? It includes first antacids. So when the patient comes to the hospitals, we should start the treatment with antacids, and then otherwise, first the sleep in a recumbent position, proper position, where the foot should be raised 18 inches from the bed. One. Second, the diet. Advise the patient to take 3 to 4 meals in moderate form. It should be moderate. Then avoid the heavy work, like lifting the weight, bending the forward. This heavy work should be avoided. Then advise the patient to maintain upright position after the meal. Means, the patient should not lie down or go to the sleep immediately after the food. After taking the food, at least 2 hours, he should maintain the upright position. Then advise to reduce the weight. If the patient is obese, because obesity, one of the causes is causing the both enlargement as well as laxity in the hiatus opening, and that leads to the hernia, hiatus hernia. So advise to reduce the weight, and if required, give the treatment and advise about the diet to reduce the weight, and along with the exercise. Then surgical treatment. The indications for the surgical treatment are, the first one indication, surgical treatment is required in those cases those cases are not improved with the this conservative treatment or the medicinal treatment. Second, the surgical treatment is indicated in those cases where the symptoms of the hiatus hernia it interfering with the daily routine work of the patient, because it disturbs the routine and it disturbs in daily work. In such cases, we have to prepare the surgery. Then third indication, if there is a complications like stenosis, which causing the dysphagia, which will causes resulting to secondary anemia or loss of the weight. In such cases also, we must have to arrange the surgery. So these are the indications for the surgical treatment. Now surgical treatment, the operations performed either by the two approaches. Before that, you should remember that the principles of the operations are that to ensure the full length of the esophagus in the abdomen. At least 4 cm length should be maintained in the abdomen of what? Esophagus and the prevention of the regurgitations or reflux is there. Then the surgery can be done by the two approaches. One is the transabdominal approach and second is the transthoracic approach. Transabdominal approach is performed from the abdomen. Operation is performed through the abdomen there. So abdomen is taken, incision is taken out of the abdomen and is open and where the hernia is reduced. And after the reduction of the hernial sac, you have to perform the 3 operations. First operation is that what? The narrowing of the hiatus, that is a right crest. Narrowing of the hiatus should be carried out on the right crest is there, where the stitches should be. 2 to 3 stitches should be made muscles posteriorly around the hiatus. And it should be stitched to the right crest, causing the narrowing of the hiatic opening, which will prevent the further recurrence of the hernia. Second one, fundal application. Fundal application means what? After reduction of the hernia, the fundus of the stomach should be wrapped around. Should be wrapped around the esophagus. That which will hold the esophagus down and preventing the what? The entry of the protrusion of the viscous or the part of the abdomen. The fundal application. And third operation should be performed for the if the any complications are present there. If complications like stenosis. Esophageal stenosis is present there, or the other complications are there. For that, the surgery should be performed. That is through the transabdominal approach. Second approach on transthoracic, which is carried through the 8th rib. From below the 8th rib, should be carried out there. And these two surgeries should be performed there. One is the stitching of the what? Hiatus with what? The phrenoesophageal ligament. So at least 3 stitches should be given. The fender, esophageal ligament wrapped around the what right crest or the around the hiatus, and that 4 stitches should be given, and you should fix with the diaphragm. What the fender esophageal ligament should be fixed to the diaphragm, which will prevent the hiatus hernia or protrusion into the thorax. And then next one, the narrowing of the hiatus, right? In these cases. What? The right crush should be wrapped with the or stitched with the muscles around the esophagus posteriorly, and the narrowing should be carried out. Where the hiatus becomes enlarged, that should be fixed with the muscles by giving the 2 to 3 stitches there. So they understood? So this is a surgical treatment. In surgical treatment, you should remember 2 operations are the transabdominal approach and the transthoracic approach. The purpose is that what? The maintaining the length of the esophagus, and second, narrowing of what? The hiatal opening. And for that, this surgery should be performed. Hope that you understood the hiatus hernia well. In rolling hiatus hernia, also same procedure should be done there. For the operation treatment is the same for the rolling also there. But in that, you should be reduce the sac properly, empty the sac. There will be need of the dissecting the sac. Here the sac is small, so that's why no need to dissect. But in the rolling type of hernia, you have to dissect out the sac by transfixing the sac after the reduction there. They understood? And if you have any suggestions, make the comments. or the improvement of the lectures. If you need any more, so you can make the comments on that, and I will be trying to improve according to that. If you are not getting something, you can make comment freely on my channel, and you can give the suggestions are there. That's all.